Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. May I request the dignitaries for this evening to kindly come to the dais and take the seat. Chief Guest, Ms. M. K. Narayanan. Mr. Horimoto Takenori, Dr. Horimoto Takenori. Consul General, Mr. Masayuki Taga. Chairman, Mr. N. Kumar. And President, Mr. T. P. Imbichamma, to kindly take the seats on the dais. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. A warm welcome to all the distinguished speakers and the guests of the two-day international symposium today and tomorrow on India and Japan in free and open Indo-Pacific. We begin the program with the national anthem of India and Japan. May I request all the distinguished guests to kindly raise in their seats. Take your seats. Good evening once again, ladies and gentlemen. The theme, India and Japan in free and open Indo-Pacific, is not only extremely important, but also relevant in the context of what is happening today in the world. Today, the Indo-Pacific is not just a geographical construct. It's a new epicenter of global politics and global economics. With 60% of the world's population, 2/3 of global economic output, and more than half of global trade transiting through its maritime waters, the importance of Indo-Pacific region in political, security, and economic terms is not lost on any country. For India, the region has been of prime importance for centuries, bolstered by historical, cultural, maritime, and economic linkages. Ladies and gentlemen, we are highly privileged to have a galaxy of speakers of eminence from Japan and India, comprising ace academics, bureaucrats, veterans from defense and security, diplomacy, trade and industry, and media. The experts will address the concerns and challenges of the Indo-Pacific region. For the inaugural session today, we have with us Mr. T.P. Imbichammath, President IJCCI Chairman Avalon Group. Mr. Taga Masayuki, Consul General of Japan in Chennai. Dr. Horimoto Takenori, Visiting Professor at Gifu Women's University. Mr. M.K. Narayanan, former National Security Advisor. And Mr. N. Kumar, Chairman IJCCI and Vice Chairman Sanmar Group. I extend a warm welcome to all the distinguished speakers of the evening, eminent speakers at our plenary sessions tomorrow, and the respected members of the audience assembled here, and the members who are watching this program through the virtual mode. At the outset, I would request Mr. Imbichammath, our president, to welcome the August gathering. Mr. Imbichammath is a mechanical engineer, chairman of the Avalon Group, successful industrialist with a number of collaborating companies overseas, and is mentoring several economic bodies and educational institutions. He is a philanthropist. He is committed to a number of social activities in the field of education and runs a number of schools and colleges for the underprivileged boys and girls. He is a recipient of a number of commendations from the government of Tamil Nadu and Kerala for his contributions to education, culture, and industry. Mr. Imbichammath, I welcome you to the podium.
Good evening, everybody. Before I start the welcome, let me make the vote of thanks for the nice words our friend Suguna talked about me. Thank you very much, Suguna. So we are all assembled here for today's evening function, and we have Honorable Consul General of Japan here with us, Masayuki Taga. Let me straight away welcome him first.
Welcome to you, Mr. Taga.
And we have another respected, our chief guest, my good friend, Mr. Narayanan. Respected Dr. Horimoto Tangawari. And our one and only president and the chairman, IJCCI, Mr. N. Kumar. I'm very happy and proud to stand before you and say some few words about the welcome to you. Only welcome to you, but also welcome to the speakers tomorrow. I will just read out them. Dr. Sridhar Krishnaswamy, Dr. Uma Maheshwari, Commodore R.S. Vasan, Dr. Swati Rao, Dr. Ito Tavu, he may or may not come, Mr. M.M. Murugappan, Dr. Sanjay Panu, Mr. Nakayama Yukiade, and Mr. N. Ravi. So to all of them, our dignitaries who has come today, let us give a big welcome. Welcome to you, all people, the youngsters and the elderly, wiser people assembled here on this beautiful day, beautiful evening, and the learned members of the audience, friends and media, and ladies and gentlemen. I am extremely happy to welcome all of you again to this special program today. And tomorrow, there's a lot of presentation by scholars to make us wiser. there is enough and more food for thoughts in the coming days. It is a rare opportunity to have a galaxy of eminent speakers from Japan and India to speak on this very important topic. I would even say need for the hour is the symposium. Today, the world is going through a very tough and challenging time. The world peace has gone to pieces. We see our brothers and sisters in countries in the world over suffer even from the basic requirement like clean water, food, medicine, etc., etc. There's a hue and cry for the security, safety, stability world over. Where are we and what are we heading for in the 21st century? It is a duty and responsibility of every one of us to continue to the best to arrive at the solution for these problems. Ladies and gentlemen, Japan and India's relations are valued based very deep-rooted. Centuries old, both democracies are peace-loving and respect each other's neighboring countries as well. The great powers have come together to establish peace and stability in the Indo-Pacific region. Our leaders in Tokyo and New Delhi have come together to contribute to safety and security and prosperity of the Indo-Pacific region. I am sure deliberation of this 2 days symposium will set new trend and provide the new opportunities to counter the challenges of the region. I also welcome the most eminent speakers of the symposium again. I thank Taga-san for coming together with IJCCI for organizing this symposium for this scale. And I thank all the eminent speakers who has agreed to speak on this symposium. Let me wish the conference and deliberations all success and also the event as a grand event to follow in the coming years. Thank you very much for the patient listening. And please remember, we are going to have a very serious thoughts being come to you for you people to understand what are we at. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. President. Truly reflecting the thoughts of your sentiments, I have with me a young student, a student of IJCCI Language School, Ms. Kirtana Ram Mohan, who would sing a song by the famous Aurora's Runaway at 2015 Nobel Peace Concert. Being at peace with yourself and the nature is the key to attain world peace. She sings, I quote, "With the strength and the weakness, if we no longer possess any nationality, just what are we protecting?" Isn't that the sky depressed? In the beautiful, cruel world, we merely keep on begging death to wait a little longer, and so on goes this theme. I request Kirtana Ram Mohan to take the podium.
I was listening to the ocean. I saw a face in the sand. But when I picked it up, then it vanished away from my hands down. I had a dream I was 7, climbing my way in the tree. I saw a piece of heaven waiting impatient for me down. And I was running far away. Would I run off the world someday? Nobody knows, nobody knows. I was dancing in the rain. I felt alive and I can't complain. But now take me home where I belong. I can't take it anymore. I was painting a picture. Was painting of you, and for a moment I thought you were here, but then again it wasn't true. Down, and all this time I have been lying, oh, lying in secret to myself. I've been putting sorrow on the farthest place on my shelf. La-di-da. And I was running far away. Would I run off the world someday? Nobody knows, nobody knows. I was dancing in the rain. I felt alive and I can't complain. But now take me home where I belong. I got no other place to go. Now take me home where I belong. Got no other place to go. Take me home where I belong. I can't take it anymore. But I kept running for a soft place to fall. And I kept running for a soft place to fall. And I kept running for a soft place to fall. And I kept running for a soft place to fall. And I was running far away. Would I run off the world someday? But now take me home where I belong. I got no other place to go. Now take me home where I belong. I got no other place to go. Now take me home where I belong. Oh no, now take me home where I belong. No, oh, now take me home.
Thank you, Keetana, for the nice and wonderful song. And it is full of meaning, which talks about peace, peace, and peace, internal and external. I'm very happy. Thank you once again. Ladies and gentlemen, I have great pleasure in presenting our Consul General, Mr. Masayuki Taga. He is a graduate of Yokohama University, joined the Ministry of Foreign Affairs, Japan, in 1983. And by 1997, he had served at the embassies of Japan in India, Nepal, and Ireland, besides having a stint in the Southwest Asia Division in the Ministry of Foreign Affairs in Tokyo. Mr. Taga headed the Indian section of the Southwest Asia Division, Asian and Oceania Affairs Bureau of MOFA in 2000. As counselor in the Embassy of Japan in Sri Lanka in 2007, and as counselor of the Embassy of Japan in Bangladesh. Between 2004 and 10, he served in various capacities in South Asia, starting as first secretary of Japan in Bangladesh. He served as the regional coordinator of the Southwest Asia Division of BOFA in Tokyo. Honorable Mr. Taga was appointed as Consul General of Japan in Kolkata in October 2016. He assumed office as Consul General of Japan in Chennai in March 2020. A warm welcome to Mr. Masayuki Taga. I request you to set the tone for today's meeting.
Thank you, Suguna-san. His Excellency, Mr. M.K. Narayanan, Professor Horimoto, all the way from Japan, Dr. Sanjay Baru from New Delhi, and Mr. Malagappan, Mr. Ravi-san, and Commodore Obasan, and Chairman Kumaru-san, President Inbichaman, ladies and gentlemen, it is my great honor and pleasure to address at this inaugural session of the symposium, India and Japan in Free and Open Indo-Pacific, organized by Indo-Japan Chamber of Commerce and Industry. First, I'd like to extend my utmost gratitude to Indo-Japan Chamber of Commerce and Industry for preparing and arranging this symposium and inviting me to address to the participants of the symposium. This year marks 70th anniversary of the establishment of diplomatic relations between Japan and India. Therefore, it is very timely and meaningful to have such a symposium to discuss how Japan and India can cooperate much more closely in the era of Indo-Pacific. Let me look back to 70 years ago. On 28th of April, San Francisco Peace Treaty became effective, and Japan restored representation in the international community after her defeat in the Second World War. For Japan, those days, rejoining the international community was the top priority of national agenda, and India consistently supported Japan's aspiration. As the then Prime Minister, Pandit Jawaharlal Nehru, considered that the honor and equality should be fully ensured for Japan. And as a result, India did not sign the multilateral San Francisco Treaty and opted for concluding a bilateral treaty with Japan. Thus, on the same day, Japan and India established diplomatic relations and then concluded the Treaty of Peace between Japan and India on 9th of June. Since then, in the last 70 years, Japan and India have been nourishing and strengthening our friendly and cooperative relations. Today, we are enjoying our strongest ever relations in our history as special strategic and global partners based on the universal values of freedom, humanism, democracy, tolerance, and nonviolence, and working closely for a rule-based and inclusive world order that respects the sovereignty and integrity of the nations, ensuring freedom of navigation and overflight, as well as unimpeded lawful commerce, and seeks peaceful resolution of disputes with full respect of legal and diplomatic process without resorting threat or use of force. Last month, Prime Minister Kishida visited India for the 14th Japan-India Annual Summit. This was his first bilateral visit abroad as Prime Minister, which showed how Japan put the importance on the relation with India. Prime Minister Kishida and Prime Minister Modi appreciated the significant progress made in the security and defense cooperation and affirmed their desire to further deepen it. Reiterated that Japan and India would continue to contribute to the global efforts to combat COVID-19 and protecting the livelihoods of the people, expressed their shared intention to realize 5 trillion Japanese yen of public and private investment and financing from Japan to India in the next 5 years. There are much more things that two prime ministers agreed and shared common visions on various issues. While Prime Minister Kishida welcomed the Indo-Pacific Ocean Initiative announced by India in 2019, two prime ministers acknowledged the growing space for cooperation between Indo-Pacific Ocean Initiative and Free and Open Indo-Pacific. On Indo-Pacific, I would like to recall a speech titled Confluence of the Two Seas by then Prime Minister Abe at the Parliament of India in 2007 during his first visit to India as Prime Minister. I quote from his speech, "The Pacific and Indian Oceans are now bringing about a dynamic coupling as seas of freedom and prosperity. Our two countries have the ability and responsibility to ensure that it broadens yet further and to nurture and enrich these seas to become sea of clearest transparent." In 2014, when Prime Minister Modi visited Japan, Prime Minister Abe and Prime Minister Modi affirmed their shared belief that, I quote, "At a time of growing turmoil, tension, and transition in the world, a clear and stronger strategic partnership between Japan and India is indispensable for the prosperous future for the two countries and for advancing peace, stability, and prosperity in the world, in particular, in the interconnected Asia, Pacific, and Indian Ocean regions." And 3 years later, in 2017, during Prime Minister Abe's third visit to India as Prime Minister, two prime ministers affirmed strong commitment to their value-based partnership on achieving a free, open, and prosperous Indo-Pacific region, and underlined that India and Japan could play a central role in safeguarding and strengthening such a rule-based order. Ladies and gentlemen, this is a declaration of 2007, 2014, and 2017, 15 years ago, 8 years ago, and 5 years ago, respectively. If you see today's international situation, it is much obvious the importance and the necessity of this shared belief of two prime ministers, and this is much more relevant. In such situation, it is really needed and welcome to have the discussion Japan and India can future of peaceful and prosperous Indo-Pacific and the world. Therefore, I'm grateful to the speakers of the symposium. Actually, as Suguna-san said, a galaxy of prominent intellectuals who did kindly accepted to speak and share their thoughts. I'm sure this 1.5 day symposium will be at most meaningful and useful for deepening our idea, thought, vision to how we can further strengthen our strategic, special strategic and global partnership and materialize the peaceful and prosperous Indo-Pacific and the world. Now, I look forward to listening the wisdom of the eminent speakers in this symposium today. Now, Professor Horimoto from Tokyo and from His Excellency Mr. Narayanan, and tomorrow, Dr. Maheshwari, Commodore Vatsan, Dr. Lau, Professor Ito, he will be attending online, Mr. Murugappan, Dr. Baru, Mr. Nakayama, and Mr. Ravi. Thank you in advance. For your valuable contribution, for your interest in. I hope you will enjoy and deepen your understanding of the perception and thought, vision and policy of the governments and the peoples of Japan and India. And I am sure you will be able to contribute to strengthening our special strategic and global partnership in the era of Indo-Pacific. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Consul General. We are extremely happy to see the torchbearers of tomorrow, the young student community, the faculty who are molding them. They are the people who are going to take the Indo-Pacific to a greater heights and help us achieve our objective. Thank you, Consul General. And I reserve the comments for tomorrow's because I'm offering the concluding remarks. Ladies and gentlemen, I deem it a pleasant privilege to present Dr. Horimoto Takenori to the august audience. Professor Horimoto did MA Political Science in Delhi University and PhD in Security Studies in the Japanese University. He is a visiting professor at the Gifu Women's University and the senior fellow of the Center for Contemporary Indian Studies of Japan and India Association in Tokyo. He has served as professor at Chobe University Graduate School, project professor of Kyoto University Graduate School, served as Director General of the Research and Legislative Library Reference Bureau of the National Diet Library in Japan, participated in many committees, groups, projects, etc., organized by various ministries, think tanks, and universities. He is a specialist in contemporary international politics with emphasis on Indo-Pacific, Indo-US, Indo-China, Indo-China, and Japan-India. He has 163 articles in books and periodicals to his credit and has made innumerable lectures and presentations. Professor Horimoto has authored and edited 16 books. His latest book published in 2021, sorry if my Japanese is no good, Indo Daisan no Taikoku e, I quote, Senryoku teki jiritsu gaiko no suikyu, which means India, tomorrow's third great power, pursuing a foreign policy of, I quote, strategic autonomy. He has come all the way from Japan to participate in our symposium. May I request Dr. Horimoto Takenori to address us on peace and stability of Indo-Pacific region and what would be the functions of Japan-India relations. Join me, friends, in welcoming Dr. Horimoto Takenori.
Hello, this is Horimoto. I'm glad to be invited to this meeting, very interesting meeting. And then firstly, I should say excellencies, distinguished scholars, speakers, and then ladies and gentlemen, not only in this place, but also on Zoom people. So I'd like to thank all of them to listen to my argument from now on. And before starting my arguments, I'd like to draw your attention to 2 points. One point is the since I stayed in India for 4 years, and because of that, I have been influenced. Say, speak out clearly. Don't hesitate to dissent. And that probably this might be make me somehow different. In comparison to the average Japanese. Japanese are generally speaking very very hesitant to speak out so that the feeling of others wouldn't be damaged. But I am different because of the Indianization. Now, this is number one. And then number two, I'd like to say the today's I'm going to speak not as a representative or ministry for external affairs, rather than that, I am simply a sort of ordinary man. So I'm not going to say anything, the official things. Rather, I should speak out in an official way. Is it okay? Okay, thank you very much. Now, I start my PowerPoint. And originally, my PowerPoint is rectangular size, but it is shown in square size. And if the square size represent trueness, sincerity, and everything, I don't object that my PowerPoint is not shown in the rectangular, but in the square. And then, in order to be more, go ahead smoothly, I should start talking nonsense, but I should start. This is shown, this as you may be seeing, this is a region which I'm going to speak on today. Naturally, this is in the Pacific. And then just to have an image of the region which I am going to speak today. And this is a gist, rather points of today's presentation, regional order, protagonist, India and Japan, and way ahead. I may say something extra at the end, as I said at the beginning that I am outspoken. First point is regional order. The crux of the issue, the historically speaking, regional order contains, sustained by a regional mechanism or hegemon. The Pax Romana, Pax Britannica, or League of Nations, Pax Americana with United Nations. And from now on, there is some talks about Pax Sinica and Pax Indica also. And simply put it to say, this is the order means the rule maker. There is a two kind of countries. One is rule maker and other is rule followers. And every country would like to be rule maker, in a so to say. And then when we consider about the regional order, there's a similarity with difference between Europe and in the Pacific. Put it, say very briefly, amorphous situation prevailing now in this 21st century. In Europe, after the Second World War, as shown here, the face-off between the two camps continued like NATO versus Warsaw Pact organization. Now the issue like Ukraine. And whereas in the Pacific, in the 21st century, tend to be more ambiguous, more than Europe, and there's nothing to be called mechanism or hegemons. So in this sense, I mean to say that the region should, in the Pacific region, need to have some kind of mechanism, some kind of the structure. But of course, it is very hard job to be achieved in the future. The protagonist in the Indo-Pacific, the, as you may be knowing, quadrilateral approach 2007, and then 10 years later, the Quad 2.0 has appeared 2017. And then everyone sort of in the United States, the Pax Americana in the Asia Pacific of the 20th century, it has gone. Now the US show a relative decline in its term power and its failure of engagement policy with China. And then this is what I said, not this is said by John Miyashimaya, the University of the Chicago University. He's an aggressive realist, so-called to say. And then the based on these assumptions, the United States have produced several documents. In this, the latest one has been 2017, growing trade deficit with China as a strategic competitor. And then 2021, this is a provisional one, the only strategic competitor mounting sustained challenge to a stable and open international system. Then the latest one was the last 2 months back, this is national defense strategy. As our most consequential strategic competitor and facing challenge. And then if I say the very spokenly, United States tend to be a very arbitrary in the withdrawal from the TPP and suspension of engagement policy, AUKUS, and then again, offshore balancing, not to improve by themselves, but to be done by the local people, local countries. And then in a sense, the discarding the policy of engagement and hedging is a serious matter for the region in this country, in this region, because United States is far away from this region, particularly, you know, East Asia, in Southeast Asia and South Asia. They are easy to do that. And offshore balancing is the choice of the policy matter. But countries surrounding China cannot you know, forego the engagement and hedging policy so easily, particularly for Japan and India. This is very important policy region. China, you may be knowing, and the Xi Jinping said the greatest regeneration of Chinese nation, two centenaries of 2021 and 2049. 21 was the establishment of Communist Party of China, and 2049 is centenary of the People's Republic of China. These two great regenerations should be taking place. And then you may notice this, China's military activity and in recent Wolf Warrior diplomacy suggest, this is not quoting from the people, Beijing will unlikely to be a benign hegemon should it somehow reach power parity with Washington. One of the scholars on China's policy matter was saying about this aspect. But when we discuss, when we think of the China, the 2 point is very important. And sometimes, often, I should say often, people tend to forget about this crucial fact. Number one is whether China can avoid salary or middle income trap and demographic dividends. You may be knowing that in theory of population, labor population, there is so-called median age. in all the ages, the which layer of the age most productive and which promote the economic growth. And in case of Japan, the median age, that is, you may be surprised to know that 49-year-old. Simply to say, getting old, getting gray. And then now China is, you know, what is their median age? 37. Do you know India? 27. Emergingly 27. That means the many people suggesting the by the 2050, India's economic growth may continue. And then whereas China's case, it is going to be diminished by 2030. So in this way, the China, India's the economic growth in terms of the population studies, it is somehow proved. And then secondly, what I care most is this one. The China's policy is to use both stick, that is without voting right, and carrot, the economic growth. The, in this sense, these two major factors, which is done by the communist government, is quite uncertain. So that's why I am saying to be a superpower or not is not guaranteed at all. And in that sense, I am saying in Japan also and some other countries also, we should not overestimate China. We should not underestimate China. We should try to be very objective to see that country in terms of its bilateral relations, multilateral relations. This is a very important point I am always saying. Now, the based upon this argument, I'm coming to the next point is this one. Going back. Yes. Now coming to the topic of major topic, today's topic, India and Japan. The necessity of cooperation in terms of economy, defense and defense for the time being. This is GDP. The United States, China, Japan, and India comes six. 10 years ago, India was not in this chart. Below the 10 countries. Now it's coming up to the six in the world. And it is going to definitely going up. And in terms of the defense expenditure, I'm sorry, this is a misspelling. This should be, please read as expenditure. The United States, China, and India comes third. So, and Japan is the ninth out of the 10 countries. But I should mention this aspect. There's argument in Japan. Japan's exclusive defense-oriented policy, at the moment it is 1%. And why it is 1%? Because the it's a kind of the anxiety of the foreign countries in Japan might militarize again. And the Japanese people as such also feared about Japan might be militarized. And then there is a very bad experience before the Second World War. That's why at that time, 1976, the government set the rule, we should not increase our defense expenditure 1% of GDP. Now, in the recent situations, there's a lot of argument, particularly among the ruling parties and rightist people also. It should be increased 2%. You just make a calculation. If it is the 1%, it is this amount. And if it is 2%, it comes to this level. But the crux of the matter is, whether we should do this or not. And naturally, Japan needs at the moment, at the present state of the development, the huge amount of education expenditure is required, and then huge amount of old people's cares, everything. Everything has to be spent by national budget. And at the same time, the increment of the defense budget tend to produce the different image of the country. So we should be very careful about that. Of course, I admit necessity of the increment of the defense expenditure to cope with the recent situation in around the country. But at the same time, we have to be very careful about how to do that in the from now on. Now, India. It's area of maritime interest and investments. We are just today we are discussing about Indo-Pacific. It is marine area things. India might want to stabilize, manage its relation with China from the foreigners, outsiders' view. To see the list of enormous trade with trade deficit, it is said to be $60 billion per year. And then Jai Shankar, the foreign minister, said in his book, the latest book, The Indian Way, Strategy for the Ascent of World. And then he seems to discuss the same line of arguments. And then second point is, India has a common cause with Japan vis-a-vis China. This is perhaps correct. We have shared a common value. And then thirdly, the foreign policy of strategic autonomy before superpower. At the moment, from my studies, I am associating very proudly, said that I'm studying about Indian foreign policy more than 50 years. And then based on that argument also, there is such clear inclination, clear tendency, Indian heading to the major power and then expanding national power and so on. So for my view, the incumbent foreign policy of strategic autonomy is to cope with present situation. And after that, I don't know. After that, India may take different policy line. And then, by the way, this is a map. Again, I'm sorry. This is a map. This is published by Indian Navy. I was surprised to see this so clearly shown. India's primary interest is dark blue. And then light blue is the second priority. And then you see Indian Ocean is there, India's main concern. And then other area, so-called Indo-Pacific as a whole, is secondary interest. So India's intention is very clear to when they see the maritime areas. So this is we should keep in mind. And Japan. Japan and India have a common cause in terms of China policy. And although there is a basic difference between Japan and status quo and India as a revisionist power, we should, need not to make adjustment because of this difference. I'm saying that this should be, the difference cannot be mended. It should be continued as such. And otherwise, it is very difficult to keep a good company between the two countries. And historically speaking, this is very important point. Oh, sorry. The historically speaking, Japan has been putting forward partner diplomacy soon after the Meiji Restoration, when Japan becomes the modern state. The first was Anglo-Indian Alliance. And then because of this Anglo Alliance, Japan was able to defeat Russia, Imperial Russia. And then what happened was during the Second World War, Japan, Germany, Italy alliance. And then after the Second World War, Japan-US alliance to 1951 onward. This is simply said, lack of national power. And when I say lack of national power, it contains many factors. But when we pick up major factors from this national power, economic power and defense power, because of the lack of these powers, Japan tend to keep its alliance with foreign countries. So under these situations, the Japan has experienced, and one more, another factor, very important factor, historical factor. The Japan has experienced foreign threat only twice. Only twice, I should say. Mongol invasion in 13th century, many years ago, only twice. And second was the US occupation after the Second World War. This is the second time only. Therefore, the necessity of another partner under the present situation where there is a relative decline of US national power, it is necessary for us. So in this situation, I should say that institution building in the Indo-Pacific is necessary. Ultimate goal is of institution, the securing stability, economic prosperity based on shared universal norms, values, ultimately to create East Asian community. And then there are two domains and entity, economic objective entity, building connectivity among the sub-regions, economic integrations, reproduction networks and value chains, and political strategic objective entity for secure the contrivance of maritime security, stability. So the way ahead, I'm coming to the conclusion of my presentation. The way ahead, the first point is lack of, please keep quiet. It is running. Okay. The lack of the governance and perceptions. In the Pacific, tremendous transformations are taking place, but no mechanism for governance due to the difference of perceptions, regional orders, and of course, individual interest. For example, the basic fact that India has withdrawn from RCEP could be understood from it. Of course, main argument advanced at that time, the November 2019, it was the huge trade deficit with China, $60 billion. It's overwhelming. And then also India, India's withdrawal will turn out to be a greatest degradation in terms of regional order making process. And then next is realistic and pragmatic measures step by step. I lay emphasis on this aspect, step by step. Otherwise, it is impossible to make advancement step by step only. The most realistic measures would be Quad. I don't like Quad, but I have to admit it at the moment under the present circumstances. The most realistic measure could be Quad, hedging strategy. But how to concretize Quad in an operational way? See, it lacks teeth in terms of utility and effectiveness. You may be knowing the People's Republic of China, Chinese newspaper always criticizing Quad as Asian NATO. But I don't think so. Because only difference, there's a big difference between the Europe and Eastern region is there's a lack in terms of the utility and effectiveness.
And there remains subtle difference in the perception objective remaining among two countries. I mean to say India and Japan. For example, Japan say POIP, free and open in the Pacific. India never say officially. India's POIP policy is free and open, inclusive in the Pacific. This is a major difference. And then this is a typical case. And then secondly, multi-layer approach to build a various mechanism where China is to be managed. And that's why this is not an easy task. It is quite difficult task. So this is very difficult question to do. So the step-by-step approach, economy, first economy, and then move toward the security mechanism. And finally, East Asian economy for regional order and regional mechanism. The otherwise, and I admit, very frankly admit, this is idealistic. Very frankly admit. At the moment, how it is think of the economic order or regional order appears soon, but we have to make an endeavor, only conflicting, only antagonistic approach to this region is without create nothing. So we have to go by step. This is the only way to achieve, particularly in this region. The European countries, European region, there's a 200 to 300 years of the internal conference in this region. It takes lots of years. And then now arrive now, of course, at the moment there is a problem, but even though it takes 200 and 300 years, but in case of Indo-Pacific, it's only matter of half century, or maybe to the longest, maybe 100 only. So I'd like to stress this point. And then this is my original sort of framework of presentation today. But suddenly I was called to appear in one of the TV show in Japan. This one, in closing, the no Japanese TV program has taken up Ukraine issue in terms of India's foreign policy. And then Asahi TV covered it in April 26. In its wide scramble feature, by Miss Oshita, this lady, TV anchor. The program broadcast nationally during the Golden Hour, and its main subject has been why India's abstained. It's very amazing. And almost all the TVs and newspapers in Japan reporting about Ukrainian issue in terms of PT people of Ukraine. It is the Russians' aggression and so on. But there is no mention about India. I was wondering why it is so. But this TV station called me to appear in this TV program for 1 hour. And then what I said in this program was this one. Gist of my argument in the program is India's foreign policy. Why the result of India's foreign policy by Mughals and the British? And then resulting from this fact, independence is sacrosanct. And the national non-alignment has been indispensable for national interests. And for Prime Minister Nehru, I'm sure there's no other way. Only non-alignment is a way as a foreign policy. It is impossible for him to imagine to have one-sided, this side or that side. It's impossible for the national feeling of the people at that time. And then non-alignment, as I mentioned here, has been indispensable for national interest. It's lack of national power. And of course, it has propensity for the Soviet quote, skewed view of this policy. Now in this century, strategic idea of strategic autonomy appeared. India as a major global power is, and its location in the ocean and landmass and it's a kind of, you know, Indian Ocean and Eurasian continent is a, like a head and tails of coin. We cannot discuss separately, but I'm not going to discuss about Ukraine issue to here today. Today's main issue is in the Pacific. Please don't ask me about this, the aspect. And then, but I'd like to say, India is compared to play a significant role, and its stance would be affecting crucial when India becomes a full superpower. What you have been doing, that's so strong. Now you are strong, and then change your attitude, or something like that may happen. So as a sort of sympathizer toward India, I'm afraid of that. And then now, the Shashi Tapu, recently he argued in foreign affairs, the neutrality on Ukraine is somehow defective. Now, finally, as my conclusions, the 24th of this month, the Quad Summit is going to be held 24th in Tokyo. It's a very interesting point, and how the India will react with other three countries. It's a kind of one versus three countries. So I, in that sense, I'm watching very carefully about this, what will happen, particularly statement, joint statement, at least in order to show the cohesiveness among the four countries of Quad, it is necessary to create a statement. And then perhaps, this is perhaps, of course, I'm not a person in the Ministry of External Affairs, Ministry of Foreign Affairs, the decision below the clerical manner, it is going on, maybe going on, what kind of expression, what kind of essence, what kind of point to be appeared in this statement. So it might be very interesting to see. That's what I want to say. The Quad Summit in Tokyo, May 24th, would be crucial in India's interest. And I was thinking originally to stop this one, but it's a kind of, you know, not so fun. So I just put another last PowerPoint. This is Mount Fuji, just for fun for you, just my, you know, kind of the show. It has taken February this year. It's a beautiful, and then some of people here may not know what Mount Fuji, Japan's highest mountain, and then part of world heritage, beautiful, and particularly top of the mountain is covered snow. It looks like a very, you know, very, very good. And the part of the world heritage, that means this is worshipped by the many people in time memorial. So this is, I just show you this picture in order to forget about everything, all what I have said. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Professor. Thank you very much for your lovely address. You have not told us how old are you.
How old are you? My age?
Yes. 49. Oh. For a person who could speak so long and so beautifully, connecting the things, first time I'm hearing to a Japanese of this age, so beautiful. Thank you so much. I'm sure there's so much of questions in our mind about not only Indo-Pacific, Russian, Ukraine, and so on and so forth. Now we are going to concentrate only on Indo-Pacific. Of course, you can have a session with him separately, and with, of course, we have the learned audience here with whom you can have it tomorrow. Nice listening to you, Professor. And I have great pleasure in now requesting our chief guest, Ms. N.K. Narayanan, to address us on strategic and political changes of Indo-Pacific. Mr. Narayanan, as all of us know, is a former senior bureaucrat and diplomat who specialized in strategic and security matters with a deep understanding of global security issues. He has made a mark in the area of international relations, internal security, defense, and related matters. Heading India's Apex Intelligence, the Intelligence Bureau, for two terms between 1987 and 1992. He also chaired the Joint Intelligence Committee of the Government of India. He was special advisor to the Prime Minister of India and National Security Advisor between 2004 and 2010. He was governor of the West Bengal from January 2010 to July 2014. They're extremely happy to have such a versatile person as chief guest of this event. And a warm welcome to you, Mr. Narayanan. Please take the podium.
Your Excellency, Mr. Taga Masayuki, I hope I got your name right, Consul General of Japan, Mr. Imichi Amat, old friend and President of the Indo-Japan Chamber of Commerce Industry, respected and reputed Professor Horimoto Takenori, Mr. N. Kumar, also an old friend, and Chairman of the Indo-Japan Chamber of Commerce Industry, Srimati Sugana Ramamurthy. Ladies and gentlemen, first and foremost, I'd like to thank the IJCC for inviting me to speak to an audience of this kind. But I think they did me a rather unfair act in asking me to speak after Professor Horimoto. It's never easy to follow a reputed scholar like Professor Horimoto, who is both a scholar and also a very interesting speaker. And I therefore find myself in rather difficult circumstances at the moment. Also, in this audience, there are several experts on Indo-Japan relations, and I therefore hesitate to speak on a subject like strategic and political challenges of the Indo-Pacific. Nevertheless, you can't say no to an invitation which the very, very, what should I say, charming and very active Consul General like Taga would say, so I could not but accept the invitation to speak. The subject also is an extremely complex one. And as you can see, the way Professor Horimoto went about the subject in a different fashion, it's not easy to make sense of what's happening in the Indo-Pacific. Therefore, I felt that to facilitate a better understanding of what I have to say, I'll speak across many segments so that each segment can be understood in its entirety. In the first segment, I shall briefly touch on what Professor Horimoto also talked of, the state of the world that we are in today, because I don't think you can talk of the Indo-Pacific without having some idea at least of what's happening across the world, and more particularly what's happening in Asia itself. I don't think there's anyone in this audience, or for that matter, any audiences anywhere, who can possibly dispute the fact that what we are witnessing today is nothing short of a breakdown of the global order. Many of us were fueled by the hope that the 21st century would be a century of hope. Unfortunately, it's turned out to be anything but that, as recent events in Ukraine demonstrate. Maintaining global peace and world order is not merely a difficult task, but I think it's becoming an impossible task. This is also confirmed by developments nearer home in Asia. Over the past couple of years, the Asian continent has been racked by a great deal of turbulence. In Afghanistan, the Taliban has finally succeeded in taking over the entire country. In turn, this has provided encouragement to a host of forces across the region, including new terror groups, in addition to the Al-Qaeda and the ISIS. Elsewhere in South Asia, there have been a series of upheavals, including in Pakistan and Sri Lanka. The political geography in West Asia, the Abraham Accords notwithstanding, is also undergoing major shifts. Rivalries among different countries and groups in the West Asian region continue unabated. All these events cast a long shadow over the Indo-Pacific region. In the next segment, I shall advert to the prevailing situation in the Indo-Pacific region, which is the main subject of today's discussion. With permission from Professor Horimoto, I make bold to assert that of all the trouble areas that I just referred to, the Indo-Pacific is the world's primary zone of strategic competition today. No one, I don't think anyone can contest that fact. It entails both great power clashes as well as a struggle for preeminence. The reasons for this are not far to seek. The Indo-Pacific region never had so much hard power and wealth. However, it also lacked the ability to handle the various tensions that come from such power or such situations. All this had remained relatively untested as till now, and as it sort of imposed on the Indo-Pacific, I think it's beginning to have a kind of a roller coaster effect. No one is quite sure what exactly is happening. I think Professor Horimoto very conclusively mentioned that point. Let's look at the situation in East Asia, for instance. Here, the situation is being tested on multiple fronts. At one level, what is most evident is China's growing authoritarian tendencies, accompanied by a display of what is familiar to all scholars of strategic subjects, anti-access area denial capability, what is called A2AD capabilities. These pose a direct threat to Taiwan, but also to maritime traffic in the South China Sea and across the entire region. In turn, it has brought a sharp response from the democratic world led by the US, intent on challenging what they perceive as China's attempt at hegemony in Asia. At another level, China is pursuing its own version of revolution in military affairs driven by artificial intelligence systems, which potentially can negate the strategic and operational advances the US military currently possess. The US does not publicly admit to this, but in the Pentagon, this is a matter of great concern. Separate from all this is the threat posed by North Korea and its rising nuclear capabilities. These are only some of the many aspects that affect the security of countries abutting the South China and East China Seas. In the third segment, I shall highlight some of the other challenges that confront nations in the Indo-Pacific. Members of this audience, I want to stress the fact that for the first time in decades, the US possibly faces a strategic peer competitor in the region, namely China. The latter is now openly challenging US assumptions of being the sole superpower here and possibly elsewhere as well. Countries in the region are hence confronting both the intensity of great power competition and the scale and pace of China's military modernization. The truth is also beginning to dawn on many of these countries that the US is no longer an indispensable power as far as this region is concerned. I would like to stress this fact and repeat this sentence. The truth is also beginning to dawn on many of these countries that the US is no longer an indispensable power in the region as far as the region is concerned. More specifically, there are real concerns about the extent of US security commitment to the region. Meantime, and during his tenure as president, Chinese leader Xi Jinping's attitudes appear to have steadily hardened. Strategic experts also point to the many caveats that have enabled China to establish its preponderance in Asian affairs, especially as far as the Indo-Pacific is concerned. Among these are affecting a decisive change in the military power balance in China's favor. I think Professor Horimoto sort of did not say it in such specific terms, but this is the reality. China has certainly established a preponderance in Asian affairs as far as the Indo-Pacific is concerned. The decisive change in the military power balance in Chinese favor is something that countries across the Indo-Pacific must understand and realize what it means. The next is China's, to use another term used by military experts, China's escalation domination matrix, both in terms of nuclear weapons as well as new forms of hybrid warfare, including space-based hybrid operations. Third, the announcement by China to set up a global security initiative, a very recent one, purportedly to oppose the destruction of the existing international order, which is said the US is now attempting to do, and instead support China's version of a common, comprehensive, cooperative, and sustainable security. Therefore, there are two world systems coming into operation. All this is, unfortunately, providing China with an impression of omnipotence, at least as far as the Indo-Pacific is concerned. I think members of the audience must realize that this is an extremely dangerous attitude in terms of regional, international, and state-to-state relations. This may possibly be the main reason for catalyzing some states in the region to come together and make a joint effort to strengthen their military capabilities. The Quadrilateral Security Dialogue, better known as Quad, involving the United States, Japan, Australia, and India, and the AUKUS, Australia, the UK, and US, are a possible outcome of these concerns. However, as Professor Horimoto very, very well illustrated, the Quad is no match to any of the other suggestions that the Chinese have made. At least one nation, India, and possibly to a lesser extent Japan, are not fully subscribing to the common philosophy of how best to counter China. Certainly, as Professor Horimoto said, it is in no position to act at least at present, as a bulwark against Chinese expansionism in the region. We must understand what this means as a region. The AUKUS is probably better integrated as far as its belief and philosophy is concerned, but it is yet to demonstrate that it has both the teeth, the capability, and the conviction to take on China in the region. In the fourth segment, I would, however, hasten to mention that notwithstanding Chinese President Xi's tight control over the levers of power, there is today in China a convergence of headwinds, to use Mao's hackneyed phrase, the wind in the tower heralds a great storm. This has its own dynamics and requires to be carefully watched, but it is perhaps too early to arrive at any conclusion. I'm referring here mainly to the economic troubles that China has been confronting for some time. The real estate sector, a driver of GDP growth as far as China is concerned, is in trouble today. The technology sector is still to recover from the probes launched into technology giants such as Alibaba and Tencent. According to private estimates, private sector sentiment is the lowest since the reform era began. The situation could become still more complicated by the after effects of Russia's invasion of Ukraine. China's implicit support of Russia has exacerbated China's rift to the West, and there are deep concerns in China about further isolation and containment, as well as a possible embargo on China exports, which will affect China's ultimate economic issues. In the final segment, I would like to elaborate on the impact of what I've just said. First, the current challenges in the Indo-Pacific are not without precedent. Next, there is no indication as of now that China is likely to act more erratically than hitherto, a view which is often propounded by leaders across the Western world. Absence of ideological flexibility, over-centralization of power by Xi, and the Chinese economy not performing as well today as it did in the past, does not necessarily mean that China would throw caution to the winds. However, and I urge this audience to sort of accept or endorse this, please take note of the fact that the combination of personalities of individual leaders and geopolitical forces often shape the nature of relationships and conflicts. This is often lost sight of, and Ukraine is again an example. Poorly handled, crisis could devolve into a catastrophe. Any signs of a lack of resolve could act as a trigger for the forces of expansionism. Finally, I have to say that there is little doubt that in the Indo-Pacific region, India and Japan remain China's principal antagonists. Both have long-standing disputes with China, the latter over the Senkaku Islands in the East China Sea, and the former vis-a-vis the long undefined land border. Lately, China has attempted to move into the Indian Ocean region and has expanded its navy for this purpose. For both India and Japan, the Indo-Pacific is hence critical in terms of not only future growth potential, but also their standing in the Committee of Nations. The welcome development is that both countries today understand and recognize the criticality of warm relations between the two countries, as C.G. Thagal said so in such an expressive fashion. The recent visit of Japanese Prime Minister Fumio Kishida. Did I get it right? Okay. The first in-person summit since 2018 and India's involvement more recently in Quad is quite reassuring in this concept, but still there's a question mark to it. The 2009 vision document of the Prime Minister's of India and Japan. I think Sanjay Baru and I were there when this took place. Incorporating a strategic and global partnership, and the Tokyo Declaration have since come of age, and strict adherence to these documents are the best means to achieve peace and stability in the Asia-Pacific region, safeguard maritime security, and achieve freedom of navigation in the South China Sea. Today, Japan is a regular participant in the Malabar naval exercises. Another welcome move is the revival of the 2+2 format for meetings of the foreign and defense ministers of the two countries. Japan and India have also launched more recently a new initiative involving Japan's air self-defense forces and the Indian Air Force. Japan and India's engagement in peaceful nuclear pursuits is again highly satisfactory. Notwithstanding what I just said, concerns do exist and are becoming enlarged about China's activities both in the Indo-Pacific and the Indian Ocean region. China's recent security agreement with the Solomon Islands in the South Pacific, in the Southern Pacific, is a wake-up call to all nations in the Indo-Pacific. It should be considered with greater concern by all countries here. Heightened vigilance is hence called for, and the main bulwark against the Chinese threat to the Indo-Pacific is a united effort by Japan and India. I do realize that Professor Hirumoto had something to say about India's strategic autonomy or strategic refusal to sort of get involved in the Ukraine war. But let's say, I think Japan also followed a policy of neutrality for a very, very long time. And I think that is the best safeguard for us as far as the Indo-Pacific is concerned. I therefore would like to stress that both for India and Japan, the most important item is to devise a strategy that can blend with the needs of the entire Indo-Pacific region to counter the many and ongoing threats. Both countries must heed the fact that the Indo-Pacific has no comparable organization to the concept of Europe in the past or the NATO today. Also, that there are many more divisions among nations in the Indo-Pacific than pressures unite. I do hope that the seminar will come up with some concrete solutions or suggestions as to what we need to do in the circumstances. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Narayan, for the wonderful address. I would request all the participants, distinguished guests, to give him a very big hand for being the chief guest today and having such a beautiful address. We will be summarizing his points tomorrow at the symposium. And you have come to a very important part of the program. I'm sure Mr. Narayan has set the order for an international seminar that has to be followed on. It's just a beginning for all of us, and I look forward to the support of every one of you to please join with IJCCI and making it, you know, a forum for thinking and disseminating information of this kind of nature. Thank you, sir. I look forward to your support. Now all nice things should come to an end, and so is our welcome address. I have great pleasure in requesting our chairman, Mr. N. Kumar, who is also the vice chairman of Sanmar Group of Companies, to present the vote of thanks. As you all know, Mr. Kumar is an electronics engineering graduate from Anna University, Chennai. He is highly successful in his business with multiple presence, and his manufacturing units are spread over a number of locations in India, USA, and Egypt. He carries with him vast experience in the sphere of technology, management, and finance. Mr. Kumar is a philanthropist, educationist, and has headed several industrial bodies and is still heading. He is the Honorary Consul General for Greece in Chennai. Ladies and gentlemen, I'm very happy to share with all of you that on the 29th of April last week, the government of Japan conferred on him the Order of the Rising Sun, Gold and Silver Star in recognition of Mr. Kumar's outstanding contributions. The strengthening of India-Japan economic relations. Thank you very much, Mr. Kumar, for your guidance and support. We look forward to your address.
Thank you, Sugana. Good evening. Our chief guest, Mr. M.K. Narayan, dignitaries on the dais, distinguished guests, both present physically here and those online, our distinguished speakers, ladies and gentlemen. It is my privilege, really, to have the last word today evening. We are sure and hope that this symposium will make a difference and promote more discussions on free and open trade in the Indo-Pacific region. As Tagasa mentioned, the then Prime Minister of Japan, Shinzo Abe, even in the year 2007, had talked about this region and had hoped for a dynamic coupling in the country. In the 70th year of India-Japan relationship, I'm sure he'd be happy and we will take this forward into taking this area ahead. We have some outstanding speakers and experts, both from Japan and from India, to discuss the subject tomorrow. We, however, got a glimpse today in the inaugural session. I'd like to first thank our appreciation to the Consul General of Japan, Taga-san, for his vision and plan to putting together this seminar. His efforts ensured that we had prominent speakers from Japan, eminent speakers from India, to ensure that the seminar will be a success. I want to thank him also for the support from the government of Japan for this seminar. Thank you, sir, very much. I thank also all the speakers and the efforts for their travel and look forward to hearing them tomorrow. We then heard Dr. Harimoto-san, this young man today, excellent presentation. Excellent presentation we heard. I thank him for coming all the way from Japan and sharing his views with us. I think he set the tone with some interesting views. So thank you very much, Dr. Harimoto. I'd like to thank Mr. M.K. Narayan, our chief guest today. He's a mentor to me, so it's very difficult to thank him, but I appreciate his coming all the way. I think his address after Harimoto-san really set the tone for tomorrow and set the tone, in fact, for the entire seminar. I think he brought some pragmatic views, current views, and made us all think, and therefore the session tomorrow will be even more interesting. I'd like to thank you, sir, very much. I'd like to thank Mr. Emil Chamer, our president of the chamber, and his team for organizing, partnering, and ensure smooth conduct of this seminar. I thank all the press and all the people for their support. I'm sure, as Mr. M.K. Narayan said, that tomorrow will be a great day of learning. Thank you all for coming today and being with us. Thank you.
How much ever I requested Mr. Kumar to speak for a longer time, he doesn't do that. At least next time I would request him to speak more. Thank you, Mr. Kumar, for your support. And I request all the ladies and gentlemen to be seated because this is the time to honor our guests who are there today. And as a token of our appreciation and gratitude, please, ladies and gentlemen, join us in congratulating our chief guest, Mr. M.K. Narayan, and a mentor to him by Mr. T.P. Imbicham. I request the photographer to cover the event nicely. We have spent so much time on the memento designing. Thank you. Our grateful thanks and respect to Honorable Consul General Mr. Masayuki Taga. I request Mr. N. Kumar to present the memento. He is the brain behind the show. A very, very important memento to the youngest man on the stage, Dr. Horimoto Takenori. In fact, please. Mr. Padmanabhan, our governing council member, is requesting him, awarding him with a memento. Is that clear? Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen, for all your support. This gentleman has come all the way from Japan. As I said, he didn't take rest. He went to Puducherry and had two discussions there and came straight to the venue. So let's give him another great applause to Dr. Horimoto Takenori. You're honored, sir. We look forward to your speech tomorrow, because you're going to be the session chair tomorrow. And I have a small request to all the speakers to kindly assemble here for a photo session, because Mr. M. K. Narayan is traveling tonight. He is not with us tomorrow for the symposium. Can I request, should I request, read out the names or please? Could you please come to the desk? You can leave the things over here. Invitation. Mr. M. B. Chammad, I think this banner would be a better choice. If need be, we can remove the chairs. Yeah, okay. Yeah, please be seated. The rest of us will stand behind. Sir Murugappan, sir, please come. Please, ready yourself. Mr. Nakayama, yeah, I, please. Is that okay? Manikara, is that okay? We have with us Mr. Imbichamit, Mr. Thaga Masayuki, Mr. Dr. Horimoto, Mr. Narayanan, and Mr. N. Kumar. For tomorrow's session, we have Dr. Sridhar Krishnaswamy, Dr. Uma Maheshwari. I don't want to miss out anybody. Commodore Vasan, Dr. Swasti Rao, Dr. Ito Toru, of course, is not here. He's going to be online tomorrow. Mr. Murugappan, Dr. Sanjaya Baru, Mr. Nakayama. I think Mr. Ravi is not here because he had to leave early for another meeting. Please. You sang a song, Professor. Would you like to be with us, please?
Come. Yeah, Saran, you also join, please. Come.
Saravana, you come here. Saravana, please come here.
Ladies and gentlemen, sorry, I would like to take one more minute with you. Tomorrow we are starting the session at 9:30, 9 o'clock we have the tea. Then we settle down in this area at 9:30 sharp for the meeting. And we have the meeting till about 4:30 in the evening. So I look forward to the participation of all of you. And I have a special request to all the faculty and the student community to assemble in big number tomorrow to enjoy the lectures tomorrow. We have both food for the thought and food for the stomach. Thank you.